Excellency.
Gentlemen and ladies of the press, first of all, let me thank you immensely for the opportunity of this gathering. Today has been a day of several celebrations for us in the state. It's the 30th anniversary of the State University, Ekiti State University, and the 17th convocation ceremony, which Barrister Kempalan was talking about earlier. It also happens to be a day when the vicarage, the building donated to the Anglican Communion by our Egon, one of the several philanthropic activities in the state, that was being commissioned in Ikere. And now, this evening, we are at the annual dinner and lecture of the E11, the prominent group of Ekiti stakeholders, of which I'm a proud member. And that has sacrificed so much and continues to sacrifice a lot for the growth and development of Ekiti. Let me especially also acknowledge the presence of our royal fathers, Kabiyesi, Kajepelori, Kibata, Pelese. I am so proud that at this late hour, you're still able to join us in a conversation about the development of our state. And may the good Lord continue to honor you in your various domains and your leadership of the state. So for me, it's a source of pride and privilege that we're here gathered again to reflect about our past and project into the future. As an assembly of men and women of like minds, whose focus is centrally on social engineering designed for change, growth and development of our fatherland, this forum over the years has remained focused and steadfast. That is not to suggest that it has done everything that it ought to do. And I want to particularly thank my brother, Barrister Femi Falan, for speaking truth to the E11 stakeholders. Not that that surprises anyone. Anytime I see Femi's name on my phone, either as a missed call or a text message, once I see FF, it's FF on my phone, I panic. And I will leave the phone there for a while before I go back to read it. Because I know it's not a demand for gratification. It's not a request for favor. It's something that has just come to his attention about either inadequacies in government or some misdeed is being informed of, and I wanted to just clarify it. So when I read it and say, okay, yeah, I'll drink water before I respond to questions. And of course, I'll finally get to him and try to clarify it. And anyone who is going to succeed in public office must have people who are ever ready to speak truth to power without minding the office. and I want to thank him for doing this all the time, but also for dishing out praises when he sees reasons to do that, which he does regularly as well. And I'm glad that the conversation that he's had with us this evening about positioning Ekiti for the future is a conversation that we all have in twos and threes in our various communities and constituencies. This time, yesterday, the executives of E11 were with me having the same conversation over a range of issues. Concerns, clarifications, positive adulation, and readiness to step in the breach and do things that are considered necessary in order to take our state forward. And being a proud member of the association myself, I always look forward to such honest and fruitful, frank discussions. And I want to openly acknowledge the incredible contributions of the E11 to the Ekiti project. Femi made certain allusions to that. And of course, many of us here could recall those very, very touching moments to which he referred. Could recall the role that various people played. I look at the faces of many of my sisters and brothers there, and I see the security guards. I see the intelligence officers. Mrs. Ajakai, don't smile. All towards ensuring that this state is reclaimed to its pride and glory, and to ensure that never again must we return to those dark days in which we are all afraid to come to our own homestead and be proud of what Ekiti used to be. I want to assure you that that unfortunate period is over. There are many people who send text messages to me, who call me regularly after reading one diatribe or the other on Facebook or on the YouTube panel call, and say, oh, we must take this person on. And I say, take him on for what? He's insulting the governor. He's abusing the government of Ekiti. He's doing this or that. I say, well, I am not aware of any law that says you cannot call the governor to question. All I would appeal is make sure you get your facts right. That's why we have the Freedom of Information Law in Ekiti State. Instead of stealing government documents or looking for civil servants who are going to give you photocopies of the papers, why don't you come to the governor and actually get the original? Because for us, government is an open book. There is no paper in government that will not go through a number of hands. I don't even know how the check of Ekiti State looks like because I've never seen it. All they bring to me is approve, approve. And then somebody goes to cut the check and pay whoever has to be paid. But I think it's one of the strong qualities of our state that our people are ready to call whoever is in authority to question. It's important to keep us on our toes. It is important to hold our feet to fire. And it is important to also be responsive when those issues are raised. But as I had cause to say a few days ago at an event by the Correspondence Chapel of the National Union of Journalists in Ekiti, what I believe we need to grow out of is the culture of no mongering. Even though we're the land of honor, we're proud of that, I think we're also the land of rumors. And it's almost becoming second nature. When something is not clear, we fill the gap with all sorts of rumors. And that, I must also acknowledge, is a gap on the part of government. Because if people don't have the right information, if they don't get the right details, they resort to other materials to fill the gap with. So in positioning Ekiti for future, I clearly want to say that many of the recommendations that the guest speaker has highlighted are things that we wholeheartedly welcome. The idea of perspective planning over the long term, 25-year plan, is something that we are working on. Many may be aware that recently we decided deliberately to split what used to be known as the Ministry of Finance, Economic Development and Budget to two ministries. Finance stays as finance, cutting the check, paying the money, but we remove the planning and the budgetary arm of government to another ministry because we felt that even finance needs a check and balance arrangement. Somebody needs to be there to give a long-term perspective in terms of what it wants to do, ensure that we adhere to what is in the budget, and then the Ministry of Finance does its own work as well. And it's in that regard that the idea of a 25-year plan that goes beyond government. Everybody knows the 8-point agenda of this government. It's not new. But the idea of a 25-year plan is something that we consider very, very useful. Because it would offer us the opportunity for integrated planning. Already, this government has embarked on a range of sectoral plans. We have a water master plan being developed currently. We have an energy master plan, which is a 25-year plan being developed, which estimates what exactly we're going to be needing in Ekiti in the next 10 to 25 years. And in the light of some of the developments that are taking place currently in the energy sector, particularly the deregulation of that sector, we feel that Ekiti has some responsibility to look at that, both within the regional context and within the national context, as well as the Ekiti context, which is why we're doing a master plan in the energy sector. But we are also doing a state master plan, which is more of an urban, regional, physical planning master plan, which would specifically identify where we want to be in the next 5 years, in the next 10 years, and of course in the next 15 to 20 years. There are provinces that you can visit in China, and you actually have a model, a 50-year model of what is going to happen in those provinces. We believe that we are right for that in Ekiti, and a lot of developments that are here, there's a lot that we need to change. Ekiti, as many people know, is not planned. People are building houses in Ekiti without any plan. Yes, they may have a certificate of occupancy, but a certificate of occupancy is not a planning permit. It's not a development permit. And because for so long, government has not paid attention to ensuring that when you build a house, you must actually go and get a permission to say this house that you're putting on this particular plot that you have a certificate of occupancy for fits within the overall plan of government. Right now, we are intensifying efforts in that regard, and the Development Control Department of the Ministry of Physical Planning is embarking on the regularization of plans, and we are not appropriate removal of illegal structures in the state. So we are doing a whole lot of sectoral master plans, but I think what this suggestion does, which is useful to us, is it helps integrate the various sectoral plans into an integrated development plan for the state. Because what we have now, so far as I'm right, is more of a 4-year or at best an 8-year plan that should be expanded to take care of all the various sectors in the state. I agree with Femi that if there is one critical issue that we must confront boldly and squarely in Ekiti, it is poverty. A visit to our towns and villages will give you a picture of naked poverty, literally walking on the streets. And our own recent experience of the social security benefit for the elderly has shown to us, without any doubt, the depth of poverty in the state. Because when we were planning this initiative, we thought 5,000 naira was small money, and that nobody would praise us for it. But I have gone to communities. I've had interactions with old people across the length and breadth of the state. And many of them think 5,000 naira was the best thing that has ever happened to them since they started living in this state. I think that for me is shocking. It's a demonstration of the depth of poverty that must be wiped off the surface of Ekiti State. There are many people, of course, particularly our young ones, and I'm glad that Vice Femi Fallon highlighted that point. If we don't tackle the crisis that is currently engulfing our youth fold in Ekiti, I think we are on the route to perdition. And government has a responsibility, indeed a duty, to find the best mechanism for turning around the fortunes of the state as it currently affects the youth in our state. And I believe that we must do this in two critical ways. One is a return to functional education, which was what informed what we did at the Education Summit last year, which produced a number of recommendations. Femi, I'm sorry if those recommendations have not been tabled to the conference we talked about, but they have already been implemented. In fact, majority of what you're seeing now in the state as far as education is concerned came from the recommendations of the Education Summit last year. Whether you're talking of the rearticulation of junior and senior high school, examinations of school principals, the compulsory examination for SS2 that refuses to present candidates for WAEC and NECO if they have not passed our own state exams. Or, of course, the merger of the three universities into one. The one that you mentioned about technical colleges and vocational education is also receiving attention of government. I don't know whether we'll be able to put a technical college in each local government, but what we have now is to put a life academy, what we call a life academy, in each senatorial district, starting with the one in Iroha by this year. And the idea of a life academy is one that really provides our graduates with life skills. You put your finger on it, majority of the graduates we produce, they cannot function in the workplace. They don't have the competence, they don't have the skills, they are lacking in even the basic literacy that you require of anyone who has had average education. So there must be a short-term and a medium-term way of retooling and reskilling them in order to function in the competitive workplace, which is why the Life Academies are dedicated to that purpose. I also believe, as you highlighted, that government should encourage public-private partnership, but government must be in the driving seat. Government cannot abdicate responsibility to the private sector. Even where we have a thriving, genuine private sector, we cannot abandon the role of government, particularly with regards to regulatory framework and enabling laws that will support the activities of the private sector. In this regard, we are making some positive strides. One of the very first things we did coming into office was to set up a special purpose vehicle for government to enable government to engage the private sector. The Fountain Holdings Limited, chaired by one of our illustrious sons, who is also very prominent in the Nigerian business sector, Mr. Benga Oyebode. And that holding company has been engaged of late in many, many interesting initiatives that are coming into fruition over the next few months. It is engaged, for example, in the plan of government to turn around what used to be the prison to a civic center and a shopping mall in partnership with the Persianas Group, the group responsible for the popular mall in Lekki, who are also working with us to establish a mall with many of the prominent stores in Ekiti. Between Fountain Holdings and the Ekiti Enterprise Development Agency, of course, headed by one of our illustrious members here, we know that that initiative should be coming on stream latest by June, and I believe we have roughly a 10-month completion period in the negotiations that we've done with the Persianas Group. Another group has expressed interest in the plan for the central market in Ado-Ekiti, which is also being engineered by the Fountain Holdings Limited. The plan to turn the governor's office back to its original state as a hotel facility, which is what it was when Otobadibayo built the place, is also on course, and we have received an expression of interest from the Protea Group to put a three-star hotel in the current government office. Another group is talking to us about Ekogusi Resort, Of course, many are aware of the work we're doing in Ekiti already, but we never really had the intention of running it because we don't really believe we should be the one running the place. So the intention is to find a facility manager that would be properly placed to run Ekiti when it comes on stream by October 2012. And the Mantis Collection, the Mantis Group of South Africa, has also entered into talks and eventual partnership with Ekiti Fountain Holding on taking over Ekiti Resort from the state. So on this, we are clear in our mind that we can have engagement with the private sector. We can organize it in such a manner that they are also not going to risk their investment. The same is happening in the agriculture sector. There are many groups that are coming in to Ekiti. Some, even through Barrister Femi Falana, who are interested in agriculture in the state. The only thing is, we have changed the model of operation in the past. There were many groups that came into Ekiti during the last administration claiming to want to participate in agriculture. And they took humongous hectares of land, 20,000 hectares in Iyemero, 15,000 in Ilemesho, all over the states like that. And for 3 years, they've not put a single hectare of farm to use in the state. We're in the process of revoking many of those land that the state gave in the past. And we have reduced the period for those who are now freshly coming into the state. We've reduced the period to 1 year maximum from the date you take the land of Ekiti to begin to develop it, and also organize a scheme that can assist to develop our own small farm holders in relation to the farm, the land that you've taken. So we believe that in tackling poverty, we must focus on reskilling our younger people. We must, of course, as a social democratic government, assist the weak and the needy with policies that can help lift them out of poverty. But above all, we must also challenge our people to know that the culture of entitlement, the belief that government must do everything for you, has to stop in Ekiti. Nobody owes anyone anything in this state. Yes, we've been put there by our people to work for Ekiti, and we're prepared to continue to do that 24/7. But our younger ones have developed a culture of entitlement that I find repulsive, and that we as successful Ekiti people who have excelled in various fields, Barrister Falana talked about it, I know of no other lawyer as distinguished and as prolific and as competent as our Ekiti in this country today. Neither do I know many accomplished professionals that are as good or better than the ones that we've produced in the state. But somehow, we got it wrong somewhere. I don't want to go into the history of where our departure from character, integrity happened. But what is clear to all of us is that we missed the boat along the way. Some may say it's a Nigerian disease and that it's not just afflicting Ekiti. But there is every sense in which Ekiti must be different, because people actually expect so much from us. Because we're supposed to be the intellectual capital of the country. We're supposed to be the one that should set the pace. when it comes to hard work, character, integrity, brilliance, and compassion for our people. So I believe that we all have a duty, particularly as professionals in E11, to help our young ones to begin to reorientate the values that we were all brought up on and that helped us to shape our own careers up to the point that we are now. And it must begin from government, I agree, but society also has a responsibility. And the notion that we must resign to fate and resort to just prayers are good, but even the Bible tells us that we must walk and pray. And if we don't walk and pray, we're not going to get the results that we expect from the prayer that we daily indulge in. So I believe we have a duty and a responsibility to begin to reorientate our youth to take their own life more seriously. It is not the duty of the senator to take care of everybody, and it is not the money in Doza that will make the best out of any young person. It is what one does with his own hands that will determine that. And for us, agriculture, particularly commercial agriculture, offers us the best route out. That is why right now we are refurbishing one of our farm settlements, because I've told the Ministry of Agriculture that they are moving out of Ado-Ekiti and they're going to be operating from the farm. Because when the ministry operates from the farm, the professionals in the ministry would also become automatic agric extension officers for the farmers. And it would help those who really are genuine, because many of our young people don't even want to be associated with farming. Their parents were farmers, and they barely managed to struggle to get them to school. With great difficulty. So when you talk about farming to young people, it is just one music that they don't want to hear. So there has to be another way of encouraging them to become more involved in this, rather than looking for government job or looking for how best to become a politician. Every young person who gets out of school in Ekiti today tells you I'm a politician. And you say, poly what? Because for them, politician is a profession. I say, well, how can you be a politician? You have just left UNAD, or you just got your NCE. What have you done in your life? What is it that you have contributed? Because for me, I think it is somebody who has managed to demonstrate leadership, who has shown excellence in various ways that would make a vocation of politics as service. If you go into politics as somebody without an alternative address, you are going into politics as business, and you will steal it. You will be corrupt. There is no two ways about it. So we have a duty to ensure that we encourage our people to earn a proper living. I'm not saying that we don't need politicians, but you must have something before you say you're a politician. I'm glad that Barrister Falano talked about the one challenge that gives me a headache on a permanent basis, and I'm glad that he confronted it boldly. Being politicians may be difficult for me to talk about it freely. It is the bloated size of what we call the public service in Ekiti. He said 45,000. I have news for him. He was being very generous. I'm sure the Commissioner for Finance will tell him that we have on our payroll in Ekiti no fewer than 58,000 people in our public service. and it is not 80% of the state earnings. This month, and we haven't even started the minimum wage, we're starting in April. This month, Mr. Commissioner, I believe you paid 2.2 billion naira as salaries. And we received what from the federal allocation plus our 600 million? We received 3 billion. Isn't that it? Yes, we received 3 billion, we paid 2.2 billion. So we have 800 million to do roads, to fix hospitals, to fix schools, to increase subvention to EXU, College of Education, College of Health Technology, School of Nursing. Of course, I'm sure my brother and leader, Otuba, will say, you are even lucky, you have 800 million naira left. In my time, I didn't even have 50 million naira left. But then, Otuba was not paying 1,000 naira minimum wage. And 18,000 naira minimum wage then, it was high in comparison to the resources of the state. So we all need to really reflect on this. In our own way, we've been trying to ensure that we don't lay people off. But we are convinced that the 58,000 naira and 58,000 people on the payroll of Ekiti State cannot be real. This is why we embarked on a biometric payroll system. And I know that by the time we complete that exercise, we certainly would have made some significant savings, because already we're discovering that there are people who have refused to show up after 3 months of our biometric payroll system implementation. They are not showing up at the local government level, they are not showing up at the state level, they are not showing up in the subed, the teachers, they are also not showing up in the various health, the primary health centers. Yet, we pay these people monthly. When it comes to registering on a proper basis, we can't find them. The same goes for what happened in the IGR that Mr. Falana talked about. We have not really done anything in IGR. Let me be honest with our colleagues. We're only starting this month. I don't know if the chairman of the Internal Revenue Service, Mr. Solaki Bade, is here. We're only starting the taxation of the informal sector in April. But for the significant improvement that Barista Falano spoke about, it came purely out of plugging leakages. It didn't come from any new form of taxation. It came from simply introducing e-receipt for the taxation system, which meant that all the monies that we were getting in our IGR actually go into dedicated bank accounts. When we came into government, we discovered a lot of money in various funny accounts, in various banks, which happened because of the abrupt end of the last administration. So the money that would normally have been taken away, and when you calculate it, average of 120 million naira when we came in October to 600 million now, it means that somehow 480 million disappeared into some pocket regularly every month in Ekiti State. 480 million is not small money in the state. So if it is going into some pockets, you can imagine how much this state has lost in the past. But we believe this is excuse for inaction to keep complaining about this state. We have a duty. The reason why we were elected is to turn around the fortune. But we cannot do it alone. No government can do it alone. We've put a lot of the laws in place, and I want to thank the honorable members of the State House Assembly for helping to put many of these laws in place. And also to thank our National Assembly members. I walked tall amongst my colleagues in the Governor's Forum when they said to me, how did you pick your National Assembly members? They clearly are the best in the country today. Because they listen to them, they listen to their contribution. And in terms of positioning, if there is one place in which we are well positioned today, I can tell you it's in the National Assembly. Our representatives are respected. There is nothing that they've asked, and we did this. We had sessions on the federal budget after I visited virtually all the federal ministries. And they were able to get one-on-one meetings with each committee chairman and also the leadership of the House and the leadership of the Senate. And many of the things that they promised that they were going to do, which were not in the budget when it was a draft, many of those things have found their way into the federal budget today because of the hard work of our National Assembly members. But they've also gone beyond that. Let me say that our senators particularly, the money that, of course, Nigerians know as constituency project, they decided that the three of them are putting their own constituency project money direct to the state. Small amount. I'm talking of 600 million naira. This is money that they could have pocketed and of course do a few Shagaluju-Yoyo projects and then say they've done constituency projects. But they chose not.